All right, Commissioners, we will begin with the consent items. The public meeting is now commencing with the reading of the consent agenda. Items 25128 through 25162. Please note the conditions of approval as recommended by the various committees and associated recusals. Staff has noted that Commissioner Nielsen's recusal from item 25141 and Commissioner Scher's recusal from items 25147 and 25148. Are there any other recusals that are not noted? No, let the record show there are no other recusals. For the record, no members of the public have signed up to testify on any of the consent items. Does anyone wish to testify on any of these consent items? No, let the record show no one wishes to testify. Will someone make a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Thank you. A second?
Second.
All in favor, please raise your right hand. The consent agenda is unanimously approved. Now we're moving on to the public hearing with item 25163, the reconstruction of a portion of Playground 89.
Okay. And so just for the record, for standard procedure, the Parks Department will give their presentation, after which we will hear public testimony, and then the commissioners will have time to ask questions and deliberate and vote.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Nancy Prince. I'm the Deputy Chief of Design for the Parks Department. I'm here with Leslie Peoples, our Design Director from Manhattan, and John Ernstberger, Parks Department Landscape Architect. We're here to present our plans for Playground 89. Playground 89 is on the Upper West Side. It is what we call a joint operated playground. That's a playground jointly operated by the Parks Department and the Department of Education. And this allows the playground to be used during the day by the school and then in non-school hours by the community. This playground was first developed in 1967 and then totally reconstructed in 1997, both times by the renowned landscape architect, according to designs by the renowned landscape architect M. Paul Freeberg. Paul Freeberg continues to practice landscape architecture and to design creative playgrounds. He collaborated with us on the plan you're going to see today. Our attention was first called to this playground by PS 166, based on a concern for safety during recess use. When we investigated, we determined that the play value could be increased and that a significant portion of the playground is not accessible by wheelchair. Many school and community parents feel very strongly about this playground and its design. Over this past year, Parks Department worked very carefully with Paul Freeberg to come up with a design that would address the various community concerns. We had many meetings where people expressed all different points of view about the playground, from some believing the playground should be significantly changed and some believing there should be no or little change. We feel that the thoughtful and creative design we ended up with addresses the needs of the whole community during the school day and afterwards. We received unanimous approval from the community board by a vote of 40-0. I'm now going to turn it over to Leslie Peoples, who will go through the park history and our design. Then we'll be back for questions.
Thanks, Nancy. Good afternoon, commissioners. Playground 89 is located on the south side of West 89th Street between Amsterdam and Columbus Avenue. It's adjacent to PS 166, and the site is 0.4 acres. The history of the playground, as Nancy mentioned, was first designed in 1967 by M. Paul Freeberg as an adventure playground. The plan that you see here is not the playground that's in place, the existing playground in place today, but the playground was first designed with sand pits on the west side of the playground and climbing structures in the center, and on the east side, an amphitheater. You can see an aerial view of a picture taken in the 1970s, showing the sand pits in the foreground, the amphitheater in the background here, and the climbing structures here. This playground in the early 1970s was deemed too dangerous to be used for unsupervised play. So it was closed to the public, and only the school used it for the next more than 20 years. You can see some of the playground equipment. These were taken in 1997, when the community was really asking to be brought back into the playground and to open the playground for community use. These are some of the playground equipment with granite blocks, the rough granite blocks, a signature of the adventure playgrounds. These pyramids and slides were a portion of the central area of the playgrounds. As I said, in 1997, a new design was produced by M. Paul Friedberg with the Parks Department. This design is shown here. This was approved by the Art Commission at the time. The genesis of this design was the curves and the semicircles, which you see here, which make up the existing amphitheater, circles around the tree pits, and the even semicircular shapes that form the perimeter fence. The existing conditions, which were that approved plan, basically show you the amphitheater here with the circular pattern, five steps coming up from the ground level, five amphitheater steps, and then three amphitheater steps down to the lower maze area, surrounded by these spray bollards, which are a spray feature in the summer. You can see here that the center maze area is not ADA accessible because of the rough granite block slopes, at which are at about a 40% pitch here, a 5% pitch here, going down into the amphitheater level. And again, in the foreground, the rough granite block, which we don't use in playgrounds today as a walking surface or as a play surface. And the transition areas between the playground equipment and the maze level. Again, this is a 40% slope here, a 5% slope coming down into the amphitheater area. Again, the cross slopes, in addition, we have the 40% cross slopes with the 5% of this rough granite block, which again is not ADA accessible. Other areas of the playground that are not ADA accessible, up on the west side, the upper amphitheater level is approached by two steps here, so we can't get wheelchairs up to this area. Also, the rough granite block is also taking up at least 50% of this play area at the top of the amphitheater. You can see on the right-hand side a chalkboard, which was in deteriorating condition. Some of the slate panels are missing, and they use that during recess and for school activities. This is showing another portion of the sloped granite, rough granite, going down to a walkway on the south side of the playground by the upper amphitheater. And again, around the tree pits, there's little play value up on these upper areas. This was a former sandbox, now filled with mulch, and then the slopes going down to the maze area. The actual playground area, the surface area, only 15% of it is truly ADA accessible. You'll see that in the blue on the north side. The other areas that are shown in the yellowish color is at a 2% slope. That's the rough granite block, not ADA accessible. The 40% slope is shown in red, and then the sloped walkway areas, also done with the rough granite block, are at about a 4.6% slope. In addition, the safety surface around the play equipment is not ADA accessible because of the beveled edge, and would need a transition piece to be added to that to make it accessible. The stakeholders during this process, as Nancy mentioned, had different opinions. The stakeholders were Community Board 7, PS 166, the school, the jointly operated school that uses it during recess, and Friends of Playground 89. The main input that we got out of these meetings and from written responses were to maintain the unique character of the playground and fix the deteriorating features of the 1997 design, not the adventure playground that was there in the 60s. We wanted to accommodate intensive use because at recess there's upwards of 200 children using the playground at one time, provide ADA accessibility, of course, to the entire playground, increase the play value where we can, increased planting and some shade along the existing plant bed on the south side of the playground, and facilitate snow removal, easier snow removal in the maze area, the central area of the playground. We went through a design exploration, which started in last summer, looking at the first design, which we brought to the community board. This design was in July of 2013. We achieved the program and the accessibility goals here, but we didn't retain all of the geometry of the design or the depth of the bowl. This design actually takes the existing five steps, those remained, but the level area at the center of the maze was raised up to the surrounding grade. So we were actually losing the bottom three steps of the amphitheater, but we lost the geometry on the east side. Then we worked with M. Paul Friedberg and our parks designers to come up with a design that you see, which we've labeled the May 2014 design. This actually achieved the program goals and the accessibility goals and maintained the geometry. You can see the curves that echo the curves on the other side of the amphitheater. But what this did was it ended up requiring handrails and fences between the transition areas, which really created a lot of visual clutter. And some tripping hazards because of the length of the slopes of the ramps, which you can see in this perspective. The ramps themselves, or the actual sloped walkways, protruded into the play space and created small tripping hazards on the corners of the ramps. There's a lot of visual clutter, which you can see from the handrails on the steps on either side, and of course, along the sloped area, ramp going down. We were sent back by the community board. They asked us to look at the design again to see if we could achieve a design which actually eliminated all of those rails and handrails. The proposed design, which you see here, does achieve that. This was the design that was unanimously approved in July by the community board. We were able to retain the five upper stairs to the amphitheater and two of the lower stairs. By actually raising the floor of the maze level by about 7 inches on this side and then gradually sloping up to 13 inches on the east side, we were able to achieve an ADA slope without any handrails or fences between the transition area. Paul Friedberg designed these curved benches here, which actually allow the children to go back and forth and penetrate these areas. It's a permeable barrier so that they can run back and forth. They also create small niches for play areas along that side. We also created with ADA accessible block, which matches the granite block that's in place today, with a smooth surface and mortared joints, more play spaces around the tree areas and then up in this upper area. You can see that in this perspective, looking back at the five steps going down, the upper stairs, the two steps that maintain that circular area at the bottom with the bollards. And then in the backgrounds, you can see the transition area without any rails or handrails. The small play areas are up on the upper area, around the trees, and in those small little niches for the benches. And by increasing the size of the play area at the center, we're really able to provide room for at least two large games down at the bottom of the circle. This perspective shows the chalkboard on the upper area. You'll remember the initial photograph I showed you had two steps right here. Oops, don't touch the board, they said. had two steps right here. The chalkboard is new. This was designed by M. Paul Friedberg also. It incorporates some math and measurement on it with the colored squares. In addition, we've included another step which faces the chalkboard so that the kids can use it during recess or during class time. This shows the chalkboard looking in the other direction. You can see that in the background. And then the accessibility that you have here up onto the safety surface area with a transition piece, the ADA accessibility on both corners, and then coming through the curved circular benches, which mimic the circles that were part of the original design with the amphitheater steps and the tree pits. This shows the square footage that we were able to achieve on the central area. The rough level play areas are shown in the yellow color there, and the smooth areas are all in green here. So you can see we're picking up about 1,100 square feet in the central area, but in addition, picking up these smaller play spaces for the children and even this play space along the curved benches. This shows the grading plan, as I explained, picking up 7 inches on one side, gradually up to 13 inches on this side. And before and after ADA slopes of the 40% rough granite block, and then this is the smooth ADA block that we're using at a 5% slope. So it's a much more gradual transition between the two. And the materials that we're using, the rough granite block shown at the top, all of the top slides are existing materials. The ones on the bottom are proposed. The ADA granite block will be mortared and set on a concrete bed. The existing 8x8 asphalt blocks, which make up the maze pattern at the center of the playground, will be recreated with the same type of maze pattern and in the same colors. The existing amphitheater steps are showing some spalling, so we'll be refurbishing them with a new finish. And then added play value to the playground. The chalkboard is deteriorated. It was done in one color before. M. Paul Friedberg did this design for us, and we'll install it with the colored slate. Also, there's some maze pods and chess pods for the school. The school is very much into chess. And on the upper area are chess pods, and the maze pods are down by the tree pit areas. This one is in his Herbert Buena garden. But they will be similar, done in granite. And other amenities on the site, the fence that surrounds the south side and east side of the playground, actually the top rail juts into the playground, so we're actually removing this top rail here, and installing a talk tube, which you'll see in the next slide, which will add some play value to the fence. The World's Fair benches, we're adding a few more up by the front gate. The bronze North Arrow will be used in the maze, so we'll be reusing that. The drinking fountain will have the ADA granite block surrounding it, so it will be ADA accessible, and we're using rat-resistant trash receptacles because of some issues with rats in the playground. And the fence diagram, as I mentioned, the talk tubes are just small openings so the kids can discover them on semicircular areas here, the little yellow dots that you see up on the upper amphitheater. The existing 10-foot steel fence will remain along 89th Street. And then lastly, just back to our design, which we really think responds to the goals of maintaining the uniqueness of this playground and making it truly ADA accessible to all levels. Thanks.
Thank you, Leslie. Now we will ask members of the public to speak.
Okay, I have the sign-in sheet. Is Diana Howard here? Okay, and as I call your name, if you can come up to the front. So we have Diana Howard representing the Manhattan Borough President's Office, and then next, Helen Rosenthal, City Council Member. So we'll give you each 3 minutes, and then we're gonna go. My understanding is there's sort of two main community points of view, if not groups, and that you've agreed to have one person speak on your behalf.
From Community 4-7 had signed in, so I don't know, we were told we were 3 minutes as well.
So we'll start with the two main groups, and then if after that, if you're on here and you're not represented by one of those groups, then you can speak. How's that? Did you sign up?
I did sign in.
Okay. So otherwise, you get 3 minutes. And let me just start the clock. Sorry. Okay.
Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Diana Howard. I work in the Community Affairs Unit for the Borough President. She is not able to attend, so I'm going to read a statement on her behalf into the record. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today regarding the design renovation for Playground 89 at PS 166, which is located at 132 West 89th Street, New York, New York, 10024. Playground 89, originally created in 1967 by architect M. Paul Freeburg, is used by PS 166 as an outdoor recreation space for its students during the school year and is open to the community during non-school hours. In 2012, as the council member for this district, I allocated $300,000 to renovate this playground. Since then, I have participated in discussions with key stakeholders to develop a design that would address the safety concerns while also maintaining the unique character of the existing playground. I believe that the design before you today achieves this goal. The design before you today is the result of hours of deliberation incorporating insight from PS 166 principal, PTA members, parents, friends of Playground 89, Department of Parks and Recreation representatives, elected officials, Community Board 7, and other residents of the community. I urge the commission to approve this design so that the students of PS 166 and the community at large can continue to enjoy the playground. I thank everyone who contributed to the revised design, especially the original architect, M. Paul Freeburg. And again, I urge the commission to approve the design so that the Department of Parks and Recreation can proceed with the renovation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I take her minute left over?
Do you need her?
No, I'll be fine.
Okay.
Thank you, commissioners. Thanks so much for coming today to hear about this playground design. My name is Helen Rosenthal. I'm the city council member representing the 6th District, which includes PS 166 and the adjoining playground. Thank you for the opportunity to comment today on the reconstruction of a portion of Playground 89. What we can't do after today's meeting is nothing. The playground in its current state is just not tenable. That is not in dispute in any serious discussion about this space. The Parks Department, the school administration, and the community have agreed we need to address the space in a way that assures the school community, which, as you heard, may have as many as 200 children out there during recess and lunch, have a usable and safe playground. And I believe what we have here is an excellent compromise design that incorporates the concerns for maintaining the spirit and the charm of the original design with the concerns for making it a useful and a safe space for school use. The community has been working on this for 2 years. I was previously a member of Community Board 7, and for even a year prior to that, we've been working on this. And what we have now is a wonderful design that will serve the neighborhood and the school communities very well. And all sides have been very well heard. The Parks Department and Mr. Friedberg did an excellent job weighing the concerns and incorporating suggestions into this new design. And congratulations to you for working so hard with the community on this. So let me be clear, I fully support this design that's brought here before you and that the community board, which represents this district as well, voted to support unanimously this past July. The design brings accessibility to the entire playground, increases a play area that the school considers critical, creates a greener space with more plantings and interesting and creative play options. I'm proud of the fact that most of the folks involved in this process have been able to understand and now embrace the compromise. And now we're anxious to move forward with the direct result of this compromise design. For my part, I've allocated an additional $300,000 on top of the funding that was previously allocated by the council, by the then council member and the then borough president, Scott Stringer, who allocated another $300,000. So for my piece, I wanted to make sure it was fully accessible and up to date. There's now $900,000 invested in this project. We're fully behind it and very enthusiastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
How'd I do?
10 seconds.
Thank you very much.
So the next person who I understand is speaking on behalf of one of the main groups is Deborah Mastriano. Is that correct?
She's not
she's
here.
Right outside the door.
Oh,
she's here.
Deborah.
They're just entering.
Is Deborah?
They were looking for Deborah.
Is Deborah Mastriano here?
Yes.
Are you Deborah Mastriano?
I am.
Okay, so you're up speaking. I have you speaking on behalf of one of the two sort of main community groups.
Okay.
So you're up now.
Okay.
Fine. Hello, everyone.
And you have 3 minutes.
It was a little difficult. You know, I'm a principal of a school, PS166, so coming here and get it taken in time. But I want to thank the design committee for putting together this beautiful playground. I mean, we're really excited for PS166 to have this expansion now that we have more space for our 200 and plus students that come out during lunchtime and recess and playtime and even discover time. So thank you for that. That is really terrific. Also, I wanted to thank everyone for creating a space that was accessible to disabled children, because we do have children that need that accessibility in the playground, and now we have that, so that is really terrific as well. Also, with this expanded space, we now have other improvements, so now during playtime, we'll be able to have, you know, larger groups of students actually playing in a more of a leveled playing field. And so I'm thankful for that, where they could do jump ropes and hula hoops and all this other great stuff that we have happening in school. Plus the back wall, I don't know whether everyone knows, is also a chalkboard. So we'll have students out there because we have a garden in the back and a reading garden, and we could bring the kids back there. And then after they do their reading, then they could draw all their things that they're seeing in their mind's eye. So I'm really excited about that as well. So I just am hoping that this is going to be it for us, and we're going to move forward, and we're going to have this playground happen. You know, our school really does need this. We need to have these improvements to happen to make sure that, you know, our kids have this space accessible, and the sooner the better, because this way we could get it done. And then we could start using this new available space. So I want to thank you, and thank you for letting me speak and give my part of supporting the playground. So thank you.
All right. So the next group representative, I understand, is John Crossman.
That's me.
Okay.
I was told I'd get 10 minutes because I'm speaking for the...
If you're speaking on behalf of the entire group,
I believe I am, yeah.
Wait, so can I just ask one thing? We were told that it could be one or two speakers because Deborah didn't include all of her testimony because she thought another person was speaking.
Yeah.
I'll sit down first.
Because I don't think I used the whole time.
No, you used 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Okay, so you have... Are you from... What's your name?
Christine DiBasquale, parent at PS166.
Okay. And then who else is speaking on behalf of that?
If possible, the PTA presidents, if there's
okay,
time.
Okay, so if you can get up, and then
okay.
So you have 8 minutes left.
Great.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
So I think we've established that we've had some controversy about the playground, and that we have two different sides, but I really believe that we've all come together to work on a compromise solution. In addition to the current principal, there were two principals before that. the current assistant principal, two assistant principals before that, all believed that this playground needed renovation. Committee Board 7 voted 40-0 unanimously in support of this. And we, when we approached our elected officials, they also agreed with us. Over the past year, the Parks Department has gone to great lengths to work with all of us to create a proposal that the original landscape architect, renowned M. Paul Freeberg, both helped to design and gave his blessing to. This adds to our belief that if you approve, our community will be given a gift. We'll be given a design that is both consistent with the historical significance of Mr. Freeberg's work and allows it to grow and evolve as our community has. I watched a video recently of Mr. Freeberg talking about the 1999 design of this playground. He said that the redesign was a wonderful example of how changes in social patterns affect a design, and he seemed proud of it. Now, 15 years later, we believe that this newest design is another example of how the continuing evolution of changes in our current social patterns, which now include more precise safety guidelines and important standards for children with special needs, which we have at our school, have all affected this design. If you approve the design that Mr. Freeberg has signed off on, and our school and neighboring children will be given an additional 900 square feet of play space for structured and unstructured play, a new design that is now ADA compliant, a new chalkboard designed by Freeberg that picks up on elements from the amphitheater floor, a better fence design with additional plantings that will help curtail a rat problem that currently exists in the area. Our children and parents still will be able to use the amphitheater steps for seating and play and to watch a yearly outdoor festival that has become a very big part of our community and our school. We'll have new chess and quiet play areas with new design elements that will help alleviate the current mosquito problems that are cultivated in the large areas of mulch now. That's a significant problem in our playground. We'll have a decreased slope design, which will allow for better snow removal and result in more consistent outdoor playtime for the school and neighborhood. Recent harsh winters have kept our children indoors far in excess of our neighboring school children. For 2 out of the last 3 winters, our children have had to play indoors for 7 to 8 continuous weeks, while our neighboring school children have had the benefit of outdoor recess for the vast majority of that same time. Last year, our children had 2 separate weeks of indoor recess, while our neighboring schools were only indoor for 1 or 2 days. By removing the sloped Belgian blocks and lessening the grade, our kids will not have to remain indoors for as many winter weeks. The new design also allows for easy access of large plows so that snow can be removed more quickly. Currently, snow must be shoveled by school staff and parents, and ice must be chiseled from the blocks. This has taken weeks of parents' time to clear this playground. If snow isn't removed immediately after it falls, it becomes thick ice that coats and shifts the Belgian blocks and amphitheater floor. As a result, our students must remain indoors until warmer weather melts it completely. Often they're inside completely for all of June and all of February, and they're only able to come out in March. We'll also still have Mr. Freeberg's water play feature, which is used by neighboring children throughout the summer. Aside from all the benefits to the community, and especially to the school-aged children who use it daily, we're asking you to approve a space that can now be used to its fullest extent. In a space-starved city like Manhattan, we need a place space that grows and evolves with the needs of our community. Our 600-plus school children don't have a say where they play during school hours, nor do their parents. And our school has hundreds more children using the space now than it did in 1999 when it was first renovated, and in the 60s when it was built. So we're asking you to please approve this design and allow our children more space and freedom to move. Allow our special needs children access to all areas of this playground, and most of all, allow them to manipulate the environment and draw their silhouettes. Mr. Freeberg has said, that seeing children doing that in this playground was significant to us, to him as it is to us. Please approve this important new design and help our children flourish. We thank you all for your time, and especially to Parks Department and Mr. Freeberg. This has been years in the making, so thank you very much.
What's your name again? My name is Erin Volkmar. I'm one of the co-presidents of the PTA at PS 166. And in an effort to save time, I don't want to repeat what my colleagues have said, but as an executive board, I can speak for us to say that we unanimously support the new design and support our principal's comments, Christine's comments, our council members' comments as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, now, John. Members of the Design Commission, thanks for letting me speak. I really appreciate it. My name is John Crossman. I represent Friends of Playground 89, which is a group of community members formed to
address this situation. The playground that you see is unusual in New York because it is bounded on three sides, on both long sides and on this side, by residential dwellings, many of which are people that I represent. There are also many parents from the school population in Friends of Playground 89. The school's over on this side. Although the playground is used by the school during its recess, for example, recess per child is about 20 minutes, including the time to get out and get back. The playground is used by the community all afternoon, in the evenings, on the weekends, and all summer long. This process has been handled largely by just the school for the bulk of the time, which I will explain. But I want to focus right now on specific design issues we have with the current design, because I understand that's what this committee is most concerned about. First thing is, this playground is intended to be used by children ages 5 to 12. The current design favors that by discouraging the use by much larger children, which, because the playground is used unsupervised most of the time, it really needs to be designed in such a way that big kids are not going to come in and take over with a basketball game or a baseball game or something like that, or a bunch of skateboards. And the current design does not encourage large children. We know that from 15 years of experience. Also, we know that whether it's in school or out, most kids play outside of this bowl area. Now, we're looking at the proposed design, so this bowl appears bigger than it really is. In the current design, there is a path that runs not only around this side of the amphitheater bowl, but also across this area here. We refer to this area as the safety corridor, and I live right across the street from this playground, so I see it all the time. The children who are busy in the climbing structures or over in this area very frequently transition from one to the other through this safe passage area, which is elevated and protected by a slope of Belgian blocks. It enables them to make that passage without interfering or getting interfered with by much more active children down in this area. And we know from reports that active children are where injuries are likely to occur. So it is a significant loss to the existing design to damage this safety corridor or remove it. Transition zones that currently exist, which were shown in the presentation of the cobblestones, the Belgian blocks at the steep slopes, which I understand at this point, I'm not an expert, but I understand they're grandfathered, they're allowed to be there now. And they do provide a very effective transition zone so that a child running at full speed this way towards the climbing structures is compelled to slow down to navigate up the Belgian blocks, which currently have a slope to them. This new design flattens this area out so much that the only thing that will stop them or slow them are these benches, which we think are more of a hurdle that they'll just jump over. And the climbing equipment is extraordinarily close to this. So what you've done is you've pulled the fast play area and the area for travel of balls, which we know from the principal's letter, which is in our written submission to you, is one of the ways kids get hurt the most in this playground is by thrown balls or batted balls. Brings those balls that much closer to the kids who are on this climbing equipment, which we think is not a good design feature. I mentioned skateboarders. We see from time to time skateboarders come to this park and try to figure out if they can make a feature out of it, if they can use it in some way. Well, this new drastically smooth surface that's being proposed is just an open invitation to skateboarders, and that is going to have a negative impact on the people who live literally just on the other side of this fence, on the people over here, people over here, and it's going to have an impact on the kids, the small kids, the 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 year olds, who are trying to use this playground and who will be driven away or into far corners of it. And our goal is to keep this as the young person's playground that it always has been. The development of this playground was driven originally by a lot of claims that there had been injuries caused by these Belgian blocks. Now, you didn't hear anybody talk about injuries today because our group obtained through the Freedom of Information Law all of the school records about injuries and established that there has never once been a reported injury attributable to one of these Belgian blocks. So what we have is a surface that has been in place for 15 years as a test. And we know from hard experience that those blocks are a good transition zone that the kids can manage, that there's no documented injury, not even a single one, and we've looked at all of them. The environmental value of the blocks is also important to bear in mind. There are many, many old growth trees in this area. All you see here are little black circles where the trees are. But these trees are enormous, 80 feet tall, most of them, very large root structures. These extended areas of Belgian blocks are permeable. They allow the rainwater to move through and nourish the trees. There has been zero consideration, despite our asking that there be such, of the plight of those trees and protecting them and making sure that rainwater can continue to move through. In addition, there's been mention of snow removal. I'm not going to get into in detail how much the playground's been open or not. Our information, and we've been watching, is that the playground is open exactly as much as neighboring playgrounds. However, the areas with the permeable blocks, it turns out, melt faster than comparable areas which are dead flat in other playgrounds because they don't form a pool of ice. They literally melt through and disappear. So there's actually an advantage to snow removal by the current. Another problem we have with this new proposed design is that of aesthetics. The current playground is beautiful. Here is the playground in use by one of the school-wide assemblies. This is taken not by me, but by one of the school photographers. And you can see children lining all of the seating, all of the seating in this playground. Now, this is important because PS 166 does not have an auditorium that is big enough to house all of its children. It cannot have an assembly inside the school building. There is one place and one place only where every child can sit, right here in the existing playground. The current design removes an entire row of over 100 linear feet of seating space for these children, which drastically reduces the utility of the amphitheater. And although we certainly have respect for the principal and appreciate her taking the time to come down here, this school has been here a lot longer than this principal and will be here long after this principal. And it should be a considered design decision, we believe, about what is the better design. It should not be left to any amateurs to figure out what is the best solution here, which is why we're counting on you folks to help us improve the design so that it will protect all of the seating. In addition, this is an interesting point. There's a compass rose right where this plus sign is, and there's actually a feature of this amphitheater right now where if you stand there on a relatively quiet day and you speak, you can have an echo of your voice bounce back from the amphitheater around you. That kind of subtle grace to this playground is going to disappear when you raise up the bottom by 7 to 13 inches and you basically flatten out this whole area and you cease to have a true bowl, because this is where the bowl hollows out. What you're going to have is just one long flat space running into some steps. We don't think that that is a sensible design. And in particular, we don't see any value in spending hundreds of thousands of dollars to excavate this entire maze pattern, which is all there in asphalt pavers that are completely seasoned and off-gassed, everything they're going to off-gas. They're settled in place. The plumbing for these water fixtures exists underneath these pavers. Now they're talking about literally ripping up that whole floor. Who knows what we're going to find underneath there when we get there in the middle of construction? Who knows what damage will be done to the water feature plumbing that's there? Who knows what other problems could be uncovered? Maybe things no one's even anticipated that could set us way back. Why go through all that expense and trouble to create a design which is less effective at its main purpose? This floor should remain exactly where it is and as it is. It should not be torn up and rebuilt 6 inches higher or even 13 inches higher. It should stay right where it is. And the design that was proposed in May, which is the immediately preceding design from June, seemed to get close to that. There may need to be some work on it, but there was some. Now, I don't have much time left, so I want to say this design is not what M. Paul Freeburg wants. I have here an email from him from this weekend where he says to one of our members very clearly that we have his full support that this should be maintained and repaired. And I'll just leave this right here if maybe it could be handed out to the panel at some point. In addition, in our written submission, we gave additional emails from Mr. Freeburg talking about how he opposes Exhibit A to our submission. You'll see he opposes raising the floor and losing a step. In addition, I think that the panel needs to know that Parks did not originally go to Freeburg willingly. They only went to Mr. Freeburg after we stopped them from breaking ground 2 summers ago at the beginning of July with a lawsuit And in that lawsuit, we forced Parks to go back and go through this process. But they were intending to break ground, and we've given you the emails for that in our submission showing it. They were intending to break ground without ever coming to this design commission to talk about this. That's why M. Paul Freeburg got involved, because we insisted on it. Mr. Freeburg, of course, worked for free, just like you did. Okay, well, if I may just conclude with one sentence. Please don't lose the step. Send Parks back to preserve as much of the existing structure, including the building blocks. Awesome. Thank you.
So now we have a number of people who signed up, but if you, my understanding was that you weren't going to speak if you were represented by one of the two sort of groups that spoke. Is there anyone who feels that their point of view was not represented? And you're on
the list.
I'm just going to go through the list in order. Just tell me if you'd like to speak again or not. Elizabeth Caputo.
Yes.
And just so that we're kind of keep it moving, because we don't want to be here forever, but Jeremy Roberts is the next person after that.
Did everyone receive our testimony, our resolution that we
talked?
Yes. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you to the commission for the opportunity to testify on behalf of Community Board 7. My name is Elizabeth Caputo. I'm the chairman of the board. Our resolution reflects more than 2 years of CB7 work related to the design and community issues associated with this playground. As has been mentioned before, this issue first came before us in February 2012 when certain representatives came and testified about issues related to the playground. Our then Councilmember Gail Brewer and then Borough President Stringer sponsored the allocation of $300,000 each to renovate this playground. In July 2013, the Parks Department presented its plan for the renovation of Playground 89 at a special joint meeting of CB7. This redesign kept the amphitheater's signature element in its paving, and Parks had consulted with the architect, Paul Freeburg, during this entire process. On July 9th, 2013, CB7 passed its original resolution in support of the Parks' original playground redesign. Over the course of the next year, the design was again modified in meaningful consultation with the architect and presented to CB7 again in May 2014. During the spring and summer of this year, Parks consulted with the PTA and the principal, as well as with the Friends of Playground 89 to address any remaining concerns. We passed this at our July full board meeting, the modified redesign at our July full board meeting by a vote of 40-0. Number one, we believe that in the end, this design preserved most, if not all, of the playground's original existing design, including the amphitheater itself, the maze design in the lower play area, the delineated separation between the play areas, and the water feature with the bollards housing the sprayer nozzles, where only the non-functioning ones are going to be removed. Number two, CB7 has looked at a lot of playgrounds over the years, and unlike many of them, where the play fields become completely transformed into things like AstroTurf or multi-purpose surfaces, the one at PS 166 is truly preserving the playground's original existing design. Number three, we felt like we had some of the best consultations from some of the best people at the Parks Department, the best design architects in the world. They truly brought their A team of landscape architects, especially since they were working in close consultation with the original architect himself. And finally, number four, we believe that the ADA accessibility is really important to us as a community. And the fact that this offers that flexibility was extremely important to us. To conclude, we feel very strongly that this modified design pays homage to the original architectural features of the playground, while also reflecting and respecting the safety and design issues raised by members of the community. We believe strongly in the design that the DPR has thoughtfully submitted, and we urge the commission to approve the design today. Thank you.
Jeremy Roberts.
Yeah, hi, I'm Jeremy Roberts. I'm a father, I have a 5-year-old and a 10-year-old girl. We live a half block away on West 90th Street. I'm a former parent at 166, and my children do not go there anymore. My kids use this playground on the weekends and after school. And while we support the park's design, we think it's the extra 1,000 feet of play space for them to run around. The opponents are saying, well, if it's flat, they're going to run around more. That's the point. We want our children to be active. We don't want to discourage them from running around. Okay, I don't want the skateboards either. That's why parents hang out. especially with five-year-olds. You know, if we see the older children there, we make it work. And as a community, we can make it work. I'm not going to take any more time, but I think Parks did a great compromise. We're very happy with what you've done. And thank you for all your efforts. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening.
Lisa Berry. Again, if you feel that you've already been represented, then you do not need to speak. It doesn't necessarily help to repeat.
I'm a parent, and my two children go to the school. I spend a lot of hours at the playground on the weekend and after school. I have friends that are on both sides of the argument, and it's really sad that it has divided our school. I agree that the playground does need to be renovated, but it shouldn't be demolished. The design does function and accommodates many children and their different styles of play in a relatively small area. With proper material selection, I do believe that the existing ramp can be ADA accessible. You said that it exists now at a 4% grade, yet the ramp that you show has a 5% grade. So I don't understand how that comes into play. I also think that this existing design basically flattens it. It makes it into a giant ball field. And if you've ever been in the playground when there are a lot of children playing there, you can see that the existing design contains the ball play. It allows the smaller children to navigate completely around the area. And this design marginalizes all other play other than ball play. Thank you.
It looks like everyone else on this list is part of either PS 166 or Friends of Playground 89.
I'm a stakeholder. I own a lot of the property around.
And you don't feel like your view has been represented yet?
No, I don't think so.
What is your name?
Jerome Crutcher.
Okay, come on up.
I've done a lot of work in this neighborhood. I've built the building across the townhouses across the street. I've built the apartment building on the corner. Community garden directly opposite this. There are people in this room sitting on this board who I've worked with in producing gardens behind some of my homes. And the problem with this argument is it is true that the devil is in the details. And when we pick the ball up, it's a long, complicated time that we've sort of been at this. This is the second, or this will be the third iteration of this playground. But change isn't always the best thing to do. It's careful, contemplated change. I can think of 1,000 design features in New York that we wish were still there today that aren't there any longer, because when somebody was looking at the program, they said, who cares about that, whatever it might be? We're going to fix this. We're going to change it. We're going to make it better. I've watched children. I have 7 grandchildren. 6 of them have lived on the perimeter of this playground. 4 of them have gone to this public school. It is just an incredible error to pick that middle. There's a lot of things here about the design that I really dislike, but I'm not a playground designer. I've been involved in the playground over the treatment plant on 135th Street. I have a history that I really relish. I've moved more snow than will ever fall in this playground if we all live to be 1,000. All you've got to do to get the snow out of the bowl is go in and shovel it the day that it falls, or the next day, or the first day that you can get to it, and you get it out of there. It's just, it's about the Belgian block are not in good shape because they've been improperly maintained. And so because the Belgian block have been improperly maintained, because the Parks Department hasn't maintained it over a substantial period of time, we're going to take the amphitheater out. I can't argue the whole idea. But I can argue the idea that by lifting the amphitheater and by creating that slope and by allowing people to actually be able to run up and down it, you will change the entire environment no matter what else you do. You've got to go back. You've got to figure out how to leave it and accomplish whatever else you think is really crucial, but don't remove the bowl. It's no more complicated than that to me. The amphitheater is an important place. It's an important architectural feature. And I believe that if Paul was standing here right now, he would agree that that is the one thing that sets this apart from a lot of other work that he's done, and certainly from all the other parks and playgrounds in the city of New York. Thank you.
Thank you.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I am not connected to this.
Are you on the list?
I should be. Okay. My name is Arlene Simon.
Did you sign up? All right, but just to go in order here, because I don't have you signed up, Arlene, but we can sign you up. I just want to kind of go through the order that I have here first, just to make sure everyone, you know, the next, I have Clary Newbit. Do you feel that you?
Yes.
Sorry.
I would like to say something either now or
okay. I mean, and I just want to kind of reiterate, like, our purview is design, so we, you know, appreciate if you could at least try to keep comments to that. It's a little late now, but go ahead.
Hi, my name is Clary Newelt. I'm a member of CB7. I'm chair of our Parks and Environment Committee, and to some extent with colleagues and to some extent largely on my own, I chaired, I think, about 15 hours of meetings, public meetings, on these successive designs in which we heard and listened to all of the comments you've heard today and many others. We had a great deal of responsiveness from the Parks Department. They listened to the community. I just want to be really brief, but we were told not to talk about safety today, and so Elizabeth Caputo, our chair, did not talk about safety. It was not, we heard a lot of concerns about safety. It was not up to us to make any decisions or pronouncements on the safety issues and the statistics, and I'm not going to talk about them here. But we did come away quite early in the process with a strong belief that this playground needs to be renovated. We believe that, and the ADA surface and getting additional, ADA accessibility and getting additional play surface both for the community and the school is very important to our community, whom we represent. We represent all these people, basically. And it also was very persuasive to us that very early in this process, two of our major elected officials also concluded that this playground needed to be renovated for various reasons and put a lot of money into making that possible, and appreciate that Council Member Rosenthal has now added another 50% to that money. So from our point of view, representing our entire community, it was not out of nowhere. It was out of, as I said, probably 15 hours of listening to all these people and respecting that the Parks Department has come up with a design that doesn't remove the amphitheater. It maintains the amphitheater. It maintains the maze element. It maintains in very substantial ways the design and the spirit that was put in 1967, that was modified in 1997, and that now, as Mr. Friedberg was quoted as saying, it's all these years later, you move with the times, and you need to do what makes this playground really work today, and we really unanimously support the Parks Department listening to all of these stakeholders and coming up with the design you see today.
Yeah, and if you feel that you've already, what you're about to say has already been said, there's no need to repeat it. But the next person on the list is Stephanie Goldblatt. Do you
have to defer?
You're okay. And then Jonathan Goldblatt.
That is I. Okay. Thanks. Briefly, my name is Jonathan Goldblatt. I've got a fifth grader and a third grader, excuse me, at PS 166. Between 1967 and today, the death rate in traffic accidents has increased tremendously. That is clear, concrete evidence that seatbelts and airbags have caused terrible damage to our drivers in this community and in this country. Those are the kinds of arguments that I heard from the lawyer and the developer representing, admittedly, the people that live around the corners of this playground. These are arguments of lawyers, developers. They are not facts, they are arguments. There is an amphitheater inside PS 166 that holds all the children. It is not true that they need to use this for an amphitheater. The injuries that he talked about not being attributable to Belgian blocks, well, in FOPS 89's own presentation to the community board, there was a footnote basically saying that most of the injuries that they had sued and acquired the information about were not attributable to one thing or another or another. They're just injuries. And the nurse did not take time, the school nurse did not take time to ascribe reasoning to each and every injury. And that's why they have uncovered this so-called evidence that this playground is not dangerous at all. Snow removal, room for more children to play, exercise, move around, plenty of quiet play area around the outside. And by the way, for the community, there is a garden right across the street, about the same size as this playground, that has lots of seating for people that want to have quiet time in a garden. They need this for recess. The school needs this for recess. We need it for ADA compliance. We need it for play. We need it for snow removal. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Karen Gooden, do you defer? Okay, thank you so much. Lori Frey?
No.
No, you're okay, thank you.
Noah Kaufman? Commissioners, thank you so much for your time. My name is Noah Kaufman. I have been a parent at that school for 15 years. I have four students in the public school system. We've become somewhat experts in playgrounds and parks in our career. Rose Harvey offered me the position for the Trust for Public Land to direct the office then that became so large to rebuild playgrounds in schoolyards in the city of New York. The previous administration was working to open schoolyards that were flat lineup yards. I did not take that position. I was the only one at the time in the office. Subsequent to that time, the office grew to 25 employees. And they do a lot of good work on flat schoolyards. They make an oval running track. With due respect to my colleagues in the Parks Department, my informants tell me that there are 17 discrete game play areas outside the bowl, which are there because of the current design. They're there because they're protected by the design elements. And I don't think this needs to be a flat lineup yard. I don't think that this needs to be a field that can accommodate a half-size basketball court. And to that end, I encourage you to send Parks back and do a better job. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Next person is Mark Diller.
I'm with Community Board 7, and I think we've rested on the testimony so far. Thank you.
Seven, your piece. Thank you very much. And Tim Marshall?
I'll defer.
Okay. So, Arvi.
Arvi?
No. Would you like, sorry, you're up.
Hi, I am Arlene Simon. I'm a parent of three, but I'm here as the president of Landmark West, an organization that has started with 337 landmarks, and we now have 3,000 landmarks. The students at PS 166 were incredible many years ago when they helped to get the building designated and came down to the Landmarks Preservation Commission. I worked with Ronnie Eldridge many years ago as well when there were talk about doing renovations of the playground. I spoke to Ronnie on Friday, who is very supportive of Landmark West's position and the position that public school or PS Playground 89 takes. I just want to say that if people have not read an article that's called The Overprotected Kid, written but at the Atlantic Magazine on March 19, 2014, a preoccupation with safety has stripped childhood independence, risk-taking, and discovery without making it safer. I think it's important that I just let you know that there's a professor from Norway that had, after having her first child, she decided to do some interviewing of children. Her name is San Sester. She began observing and interviewing children on playgrounds in Norway. In 2011, she published her results in a paper called Children's Risky Play from an Evolutionary Perspective, The Antiphobic Effects of Thrilling Experiences. Children, she concluded, have a sensory need to taste danger and excitement. This doesn't mean that what they do has to actually be dangerous, only that they feel they're taking a great risk. I won't read you all the things that she said, but she ends by saying, exploring on one's own. And the last one Sancestor describes as the most important for the children, she told me. When they are left alone and can take full responsibility for their actions and their consequences of their decisions, it's a thrilling experience. So I just want to make sure that I did work with Freeburg in the past, that I have spoken to Ronnie Eldridge, and as late as Friday. And my children grew up in a Dattner playground. I live on West 67th Street, and I'm not sure I understand, but there are all kinds of Belgian blocks. I don't understand the ADA talk that the Parks Department has at this moment, but I can only say that I have three children. I may not have been a good mother, but they all survived to tell the tale. So one is 51, one is 49, and one is 48, I think. But they're here to tell you that they had a great time in the playground and nothing terrible happened. So I'm pleased with Richard Dattner and I'm pleased with Freeburg as well. So I thank you.
So at this time, the commission will, as I mentioned, deliberate and ask questions and then vote.
I'll take the first stab. As members of the public, I'm also the landscape architect representative to the commission. We thank you all, the commission thanks you all, the public, for your deep concern in the future design, and it's really very gratifying to us to know how many people care about good design, because that's theoretically what we're here to do as well. And as the executive director mentioned on several occasions, the best we can do is to limit our comments to those that are aesthetic. We really can't evaluate issues of safety. We have to accept the discussions about programming, and we certainly would not challenge a modification for regulatory reasons of making the playground up to code. That is not debatable. The commission has the utmost respect for the landscape architecture work of M. Paul Freeburg. In full disclosure, I worked for him for a time in my life. And we very much appreciate that he has collaborated with you on the modifications that we see prepared here. We fully understand, and Ms. Simon spoke about the Dattner playgrounds. We also have reviewed a number of those at Central Park. And we ask that both the Central Park Conservancy and the Parks Department evaluate the context and the qualities of the existing conditions before any design is advanced. And I think that you've done a very thorough presentation in explaining to us the history, the design evolution, and the degree to which this is consistent with the aesthetics of the original design, which albeit have been significantly altered with the redesign in 1997. And I think that actually is quite an important point. Again, some of the playgrounds we look at in Central Park where the original Dattner scheme is in complete tact, it's a very different approach than a situation like this where a number of elements, for better or worse, were significantly modified in the 90s. I would like to ask whether there are any other commission members who'd like to say something.
Can I ask you a small question? As a landscape designer, how are the trees going to fare in the new, in this recent, most recent design?
I think I'll ask.
We have we've given our trees a greater area of porous granite block. The accessible block we can make porous as well. So we've made a bigger area for the tree so the water can infiltrate. So we're taking care of the trees. We're improving the condition for the trees. We're also adding a couple more.
And all there aren't any being taken away?
No, no. These are new because we're trying to get, whoops, oh, I'm sorry, they said don't touch. There's some missing on the south side, so we're putting in new trees, and that's to put shade onto the playground. And the existing big trees, they're going to have a bigger area of porous pavement around them. So we've increased the area of porous pavement around these existing trees.
I see.
Yeah, we're very conscious about protecting our existing trees.
Just to clarify, another clarifying question. Those curvilinear barriers, you referred to them as barriers and they were discussed, but were they also conceived as seating?
As seating, they're 16 inches high. They're seating either to look at the play equipment or back towards the amphitheater. And I mentioned that they were permeable, meaning that the kids can actually run between them, but it'll keep balls from going back and forth.
Those three curves are the part of the design that I find most problematic. Is there a view I just find them aesthetically jarring. I find especially the southernmost curve the biggest problem.
We had a couple of different designs for this, and this is what we really worked with Paul. And listening to the Friends of Playground 89 wanting these other small spaces. So this was, you know, at one point we had one seating element. And then we made these little smaller places. And it's the idea that it'd be give a sense of containment to the bowl by providing these other small placements.
I agree with Byron, they're very awkward feeling in the space. I don't like the way that one on the right juts out of the paving. I mean, I personally think they're problematic. I'm not against the concept, but I don't find them at all successful. I think they look jarring. That's the word you use.
Clunky. Yeah. I think it could be worked on.
I think the bowl needs the enclosure, but perhaps a little more thinking as to what that might look like.
I would add that I concur, and particularly with the seating element that's most to the right and falls out of the containment of the paving.
I'd like to add, though, that that's the only part of the design that I find really problematic. I really appreciate that the original designer has been involved in this over 47 years. That's quite a remarkable note.
Yeah, he was so generous with his time, and it's a very good collaborative relationship.
You say there's supposed to be a play area within those little curves of the seating. What kind of play area? I'm talking about the seating.
Right. Some people in the community like these little gathering spaces where girls can gather and have a little game. With girls was mentioned specifically, but it could be boys. And so these little sort of smaller eddies. So when the playground's full of kids running around at lunchtime, there can be these smaller places where kids could play a small game or just two of them could sit or three of them could sit. So that's what we were trying to increase, those number of little places, more intimate places.
You have other places there besides these?
So in this little, we originally thought when we were talking to Paul,
all together, because these little places make those kind of spaces. But then this little place here, there's greater places up here. We added another seat that looks at the
chalkboard in the back. Right, and there's also the mazes. There's the maze pods here up in this area. And there's also maze pods here, which are chess pods. The school is known for their chess players.
So it's just like richer number of places to sit. And
so is there a quiet place between the amphitheater, the amphitheater seating and the chalkboard?
Yeah.
What is between there?
Before that had steps and it had granite block and some trees that just didn't make it, and they won't because they're right.
So you envision that as a quiet play
area? Sort of a quiet place. It could be used for a lot of different things, and there could be a lot of activity around this very creative chalkboard.
So you see how the amphitheater, the steps as seating, they feel more like seating than, I mean, that's also a structure that separates this area in front of the chalkboard from the amphitheater, and the area with the three curves feels more like a barrier than it does seating. So that's my main point. If it could be re-looked at and thought more of as seating, possibly, and secondarily as a separation, seating slash that kind of play area that you're talking about.
Right.
I think that might be more.
Not this, but the back. What?
Yeah, the other side. The three curved benches. The three curved.
Yeah.
What is the angle of that? Where those three benches are?
That's a 5% slope. The slope actually coming down.
Yeah.
And you saw that in.
Right. Some member of the public got confused between 4% and 5%. It's 40% to 5%.
So right now,
this is
the
ramp.
So right now, this is the granite block, so it's bumpy granite block. And instead, we're making that a 2% and a 5% slope, so that we don't have to add the handrails to make
right.
this.
So the 40% is gone.
It's gone. The 40% is gone. Actually, the member of the public was talking about.
I understood that. There is a 4%
existing. It's a 4.6%, but it's not ADA accessible because it is made up of the rough granite
right.
block, so it's not accessible down to the floor.
I understood that.
Thank you for that clarification.
You know, it's always difficult when you have a work that's been designed by a well-known architect such as Paul Friedberger. I think we all have to be respectful of the fact that he really is a great landscape architect. At the same time, things change in people's attention to how they play and how they want to play. And the way we parents encourage their children to play 40 years ago may be very different than the way people encourage their children today. And I think that the plan is an excellent plan. I think you've done a great job. I think that you have preserved some significant elements of the Friedberg design, and I commend you for that. I don't think it's an open play area without reservation at all. I think that comment can't be sustained. And I think it really helps make the playground usable and accessible to people today, and we need to be respectful of those changes. So I share my colleague's concern about the three barrier benches. Why don't we call them barrier benches to give you a sense of our view? But I support the plan completely with the suggestion that we ask for some modification of that limited piece post-art.
I'm a little confused. An email's been passed around during the course of this activity. Presumably from Paul Friedberg, in which it appears that it's a very confused email, I must say, but it appears to be suggesting some support for the opponents of your plan, although it's hard to understand what he's saying. Do you have anything to say about what side of this controversy Mr. Friedberg is on?
You know, we work cooperatively with him. It was a very good relationship. We're still developing details with him. He's still working with us. He understands this is it's a compromise design between two different people who want different program goals. And he found this was a good, things he said to me, it was a good compromise.
He's supportive of this compromise?
And we didn't, yeah, he's supportive of it as a compromise, and he didn't feel like we had destroyed or negatively impacted its design. He feels that designs for playgrounds should change over time. So that's, you know, that's what I can say. That's our experience with them.
Let me just remind everyone, we are going to vote today, yay or nay, on a preliminary. So we can put in requests. I've certainly heard one raised already. But obviously, as I think Mr. Kretschmer said, there are details to be worked out that are very important, and so we assume that you will continue to work to refine those. So are there any other commissioners who would like to say something? All right, from the tenor that I understood, there is a motion to approve with the condition that the barrier benches will be re-examined for their aesthetic relationship and bowl enhancing qualities. Would someone like to make a second with that?
I'll second it.
All in favor of preliminary approval with those conditions? Thank you.
Thank you.